Well, as you can see, we're having a good freeze at the moment. Hasn't been above freezing for a few days. I actually started the Land Rover last night. It's sat for a couple of weeks, fired straight up. I was quite surprised by that. Let's talk about fuel. So while on the subject, I have found that even with super unleaded in the tank, if I leave it for more than 2 weeks, it won't start. The fuel seems to go off really quick. I never used to have that trouble. And that's with super unleaded. I've been avoiding E10 wherever possible. Anyway, first job is the fuel sender from the auxiliary tank. There's always been a smell of fuel in the cabin since I fitted the tank. And obviously you've got a cork gasket in the tap. You're always going to get a slight bit of vapour from that, I guess, being a slightly sort of porous material. But I noticed that every time I filled the tank, this little sender unit was ending up with a pool of fuel in the top. And I initially thought it was the screws, the fuel was coming up the screw threads and I hadn't used the right washers. But actually it was coming up around these connections, the terminals that go through the unit, which is really quite annoying. So what I'm going to do is make a little blanking plate instead of this. I've never had it connected, I don't really need it. And I have found some rounds that have come off a fly press. So a bit of aluminium there, which is just about the right shape. So we'll try and do something with that. But I'm going to take this apart and use the top as a template. Anyway, it's a brick part one, it hasn't lasted very long. But the rest of it seems to have been alright. So yeah, a bit of a shame really. You can see the seal lifted in there, where it's perished already. The usual problem at the moment of rubber components not lasting more than a matter of weeks. You can see I've just drilled out the spot welds and I'm now just milling off these crimped bits here. The best I can, I'll probably tidy it up with a file. It's a bit of a bodging really, but it'll be okay once it's got a gasket and the blanking plate between it. The reason I'm not just going to use the blanking plate on its own is because it's so thin. And with the necessary cork gasket, it'll just flex and leak, so this one with the nice return edge on it should make it reasonably strong. I just transfer punch the holes through and then use something called a Whitney punch. In case you're not familiar, you've just got punch and die that goes in the tool, very useful for making brackets up and this sort of thing, and they leave a nice clean hole. Rather than drilling, you'd be out with a countersink deburring that, whereas that's good enough to go straight away. It's a bit of stainless actually, so that's quite good. I'm going to put a gasket between these two because if fuel comes up the screw threads, it will get under that. So we'll put a clinger gasket between that, and then it can all tighten down on the original cork gasket. Some decent seal washers under the screw heads, and that'll be quite acceptable, I think. There we have it. I think we're basically at the point where the seat box can go in now. Just put the Roman drive operating lever and bracket on. I think I took that off before taking the seat box out, but I'm pretty sure I should be able to sort that, no issues. See, the prop shafts are back on. I did that one night this week. That one's had a new universal joint that end. It's just a little bit of play in there, so they've been taken apart and greased, the sliding splines cleaned up, that kind of thing. I did the front one as well, but didn't need any new joints. The little blanking plates in place on the fuel tank, that's worked out. Fitted it with no washers, just some sealant on the screw threads. Something called Heldite, which is fuel proof. That's about it really. I'm going to just go around with the scrubbing brush and just clean up what I can while I've got access. Then it's going back together. I've got the fuel tap like the right way up, ready to go back on the seat box. The handbrake mechanism will have to be put in once that's back in, but not a lot to do now, just lots of little M10 bolts. Gear oil showing on the dipstick still, so I've just done a few checks like that, so I can just drive it once it's back together. Still showing no signs of de-icing. be raining in here later. Getting on pretty well now, the seat box is bolted in. Those ones up there are always particularly challenging, but we've got them done. So all new stainless bolts all the way around. Been using stainless bolts on this for a long time, no issues with corrosion, as a lot of people will tell you I should have. It's been absolutely fine. Just trying to get this to de-ice a little bit. It might be dry when I want to drive it tomorrow. And it's warmer to work. Nice light to work by. I'm going to try and get the transmission tunnel in. And then get the floor in. You'll note I've cut the return edges off my transmission tunnel a long time ago. And it means that I can take the tunnel out without taking the floor out. Not particularly nice, but it's very useful. I had to adjust the Rover drive lever bracket to get clearance between gearbox and seat box. It's a bit close, but it should be okay. But yeah, I'm hoping if I can get the floor in, I can drive it tomorrow. That'd be really nice. As you can see, the soundproofing's back in. Always a bit of a mission getting that in, but it fits all right. Just a bit of juggling while you get it over the various key levers. Handbrake's back in and adjusted. And I've just reattached the fuel changeover valve to the seat box. Yeah, I'm pretty sure that's it. So I can now finish putting the levers and the red and yellow knobs on. Oh, I can put the seats in. Apparently it's minus five at the moment. Let's see if you'll start up. Set the camera up. Let's go for a drive. Been driving for about 10 miles now. Been a little easier than I expected. Main trouble today was getting some heat in the engine actually. The camera mounts on its last leg, so do excuse the camera juggling around a bit. Not a lot I can do about that. It's quite noisy at the moment, particularly on sort of overrun, backlash kind of thing. I kind of know more or less than it should be, really. It's all new. The clutch is just disengaging when it's on the floor. Again, that's all new. So having to be a bit careful not to change gears too sharply at the minute. Overrun. Listen when I go back on the power. And now we're driving, it's quiet again. So it's pretty normal. Wasn't bang and clunk. Very little slack in the drive. It's really good.
gun because they made cannons around here and cannonballs, I believe. Hence Thunder's Hill, where they tested the guns. I think this is our little cut through. Codger's Cross, that's it. To stop and take it up through the gear so you can hear it, and I'll stop talking. Photo, I think. Snow tonight, so I might well come to work this way tomorrow morning. Avoid the salt. I hate driving this thing on salty roads. Chattery than the old gearbox was, so I could take off in fourth gear from 20 miles an hour without it all rattling and it was terrible.
Just had a look, see if there's any oil leaks underneath. It's all good. Doesn't look like any weeps at all, which is great. I hope you enjoyed that as much as I did. I'll see you in the next one.
Thanks for watching.